go ahead and get started. So I want to talk a little about my transition, some of the things I've learned, talk a little about if I could do it all over again, and then where I'm at now, some resources that are available to you, and then I'll be available for any questions should any come up in the Q&A. So when I began my transition out of service, it was horribly misguided. I used a blanket resume. I had no professional network, and I definitely was not operating a targeted job search. So if you think of all the things that likely everyone at this conference has told you to do, think of the inverse. So like many of you now, someone was telling me all of the things I should be doing, but I didn't think they applied to me. I honestly thought that I didn't need a targeted resume. There was no need to network. And as many of you may expect, my results were a function of the effort that I put in. So there were none. So my resume went without response and my college application was stagnant. I was pretty sure that the entire hunt, my transition was somewhat screwed. I had gotten a late start. And at that point, I was pretty certain that there was no hope. However, I swallowed my pride and I reached out for help. And that friend obliged. And with his help, that previously poor resume landed a dream role and a college application that was stagnant moved on and got scholarships. The hopeless battle you were fighting can become an easy one solely by reaching out to a friend. Now, there's a bunch of common misconceptions that we always see at Boots to Books that I want to dispel. So I'm going to give you a couple. First is the job search is going to be easy. I don't think anyone has gotten out of the service and had an easy transition, even if they were the head of logistics in the service and transitioned out to manage federal logistics contracts. They still had a job hunt. They still had a resume. They still had interviews. It'll never be easy, but it is rewarding. Now, the second is that I deserve a job. Sure, you do, but that mentality is not going to get you anywhere. Getting out of the service and thinking that you deserve something or that the recruiter is out of their mind for not giving you a job isn't a mentality that's going to make you any progress. The next is the ATS is killing me. And this is a fallacy I fell in, that the applicant tracking system is out to get you and that you'll upload your resume and it'll be scanned and parsed for words and, you know, no one will ever see it. And it's partially true. It will be scanned for words to see if you're meeting the minimum qualifications they ask for in the job description. But that's to save the recruiter time from seeing 100 resumes that just don't meet what they're looking for. Look at the job description, tailor your resume to it, and the ATS will be to your benefit, not detriment. The next one is you have to work in a certain industry or you have to do a certain role or what you did when you were in the service. This could not be further from the truth. I think this conference is almost dedicated to people making a transition into cybersecurity, whether it be after they've transitioned out or during their transition, but it is completely possible and it doesn't matter really where you end up. It's pretty much always doable. Or where you are in your transition. And the next one is a relatively funny one. And this is one of my favorites. It's that I deserve to make $100,000 working remotely the first year out of the service. And there's people who are almost intent on refusing anything less. And I completely understand you value yourself and you know that you have experience and want to get paid for it. However, that's an extremely high bar. And when making a transition, setting that high of a bar just means it's going to be that much harder to succeed. And if you only have that public sector military experience, you're going to have a hard time translating it to private sector, $100,000 a year worth of experience. So it might be something you have to do to take an internship, take a lower level role to get into that industry. So I totally understand that there is a lot of information flying around. It's a very stressful time and you don't know what to expect. But we have to cast some of those misconceptions aside. Individuals can, and I've seen them firsthand, change industries extremely successfully. I know infantrymen that are now leading cybersecurity teams. I'm an infantryman in financial services. But your success is reliant on taking advantage of the resources available to you. So I want to talk a little bit about some of the resources available to you and what I would do if I could redo my transition. So first, I want to acknowledge that people are in varying stages of their journey in this room, but I think the insights here can be applied regardless of where you are. So to start, before you get out of the service, or even if you've already transitioned, you need to do some soul searching. Too many people get out and feel like they have to do the role they did in the service. They have to work in a certain industry. There's truly nothing you have to do anymore except find something to do. So it can be any industry. Now, it's difficult to figure out what you want to do if you've never done it before. So how do you go about doing that? First, my advice is do some research on your own. Get a sense, right? Google, LinkedIn, YouTube, anything you can really do to learn a little bit about the industry and what might interest you. Now, let's just say, for example, you found three things that really interest you. You've narrowed it down. From there, go on Veterati to a Vets to Industry event, to a Boots to Books event, and speak with people in or knowledgeable about those three roles. Here's why you're going to do that. That informational interview, that networking. Everyone thinks that it doesn't apply to them and they can send blanket connection requests and resumes and jobs will appear, but that is not the case. Informational interviews and networking are not just approaching requisite status. They will let you actually see into a career what it's really like day to day while you're building a network. It is a win-win for you. Now let's assume you know what you want to do. You've had those three informational interviews or about those three roles and you found one that really just sticks out to you. Okay? Amazing. You've done the first part. Now that you've found that dream role, you're going to have to become your own harshest critic. You need to determine what gaps there are between your resume and your dream role. You need to ask your informational interviewee. You need to research, let's say 10 job descriptions for that role and find the commonly occurring criterion. If you don't have several of them, it's time to start thinking about how you're going to build your professional profile to meet them. So let's look at two common causes here of once you found that dream role, why you might be falling short of actually getting it. We'll say knowledge or education and experience. So starting with knowledge, some industries will simply require a certain degree or certification. For instance, some financial services careers require a bachelor's degree without compromise. Some cybersecurity roles expect base level certifications like A+ and Net+. Well, paying thousands of dollars to get them is likely off the table unless you save like crazy in the service. So how can you upskill for free or without paying cash out of pocket? Well, your benefits if you're in the service include credentialing assistance. The Army's just came back online, as well as the GI Bill. So those might be able to cover some of your programs or after the GI Bill. Those are your benefits. But outside of your benefits, there are organizations that will help you get trained for free. Organizations like mine, Boots to Books, or will buy your CompTIA vouchers, Lean Six Sigma, and more for you if you're a recipient of one of our application cycles. There's the Institute for Veterans and Military Families, there's Act Now Education, and more. If you want help finding some free resources, don't hesitate to reach out to Boots to Books. The knowledge portion is entirely a function of your willingness to put in hard, consistent studying. There are a plethora of organizations who want to cover it or offer free training. And there's a variety of ways that you can demonstrate to recruiters that you're putting in that effort and getting that knowledge without spending money. It just requires you doing research and applying. Now, let's touch a bit on experience, which I think is really the true sticking point for most people. So firms want experience to hire you, but you can't get hired without experience. What the hell? Well, let me try and propose a few remedies, all of which I've done myself. First is, and this is a hard one to hear, but a necessary one, get off the hot horse. Be willing to take the internship, the junior role at the tiny company, or the admin role at the company you're looking for. It doesn't matter. Get in where you can. And I know that's hard to hear because people know that they need to value themselves getting out, and I agree. But if you get an opportunity to get into the industry that you're looking to get in, it doesn't matter what the title is, unless it is, you know, something you'll absolutely hate doing, you should take it. And at least use it to build your experience while you look for the role that does suit you, you know, and suit that experience you have. Second is, experience doesn't have to be paid. Especially true if you're a student. It doesn't have to be some ultra competitive internship either. There are organizations desperate for volunteers. If you do your research, you might just find an organization who's willing to give you upskilling and experience. I know there's organizations that are looking for volunteers specifically in cybersecurity. It's just a function of you doing your research, once again, and reaching out and offering. Companies love to see someone who's actually put their skills to the test and use them, and it doesn't have to be paid. You doing it in a volunteering capacity is still employing them. Third, and this is an interesting one, is start your own thing. So it doesn't have to be a profit-seeking venture that you intend on using to sustain yourself, but some way of demonstrating your mastery in whatever skill set you're trying to get hired for. So to give you an example, let's say someone attending this event, a cybersecurity individual, built a website that depicts all the capture the flags, all the events, their home lab maybe they've built, the trainings and volunteer work they've done, and that link is what they sent out. Or an individual who's interested in finance making a LinkedIn newsletter that breaks down latest news and her personal take on them. How many people do you see truly seeking to differentiate themselves with a passion for the industry? I landed my first financial services role out of the service at a tiny family office, and it was the best thing that could have happened to me. This was the epitome of finding a place to get in. From there, I networked like mad, connected with a great recruiter, and thought I was a lock for a job at a fantastic firm. Unfortunately, the recruiting cycle had ended. I was sad. I thought my journey had ended, and so many other things. But 5 months later, before the next cycle had begun, that recruiter had an email from me in her inbox with an updated resume and a respectful email about how I was excited about their firm and a great fit for the role. Sure enough, it worked. Now, this isn't supposed to be some boasting story or a trials and tribulations monologue, but it is to show that there are things you can do to make yourself successful in the job hunt, many of which just rely on hard work, research, and networking. My transition was definitely a contradiction. The first half, time spent learning how to do it right, but not networking, sending blanket resumes, not having a target role, until I got that help and realized a few of these things I've tried to tell you today. So I want to leave you with a few things and hope they serve as a source of hope for you in these tumultuous times. First is, get in where you can. Take the junior role, the internship, whatever you can to get the experience and begin building that network at the company. The second, your success is a function of the work you put in. You own this transition, not anyone else. Third, use the resources available to you. Whether it be Boots to Books or any of the other great organizations, they're here and they're free for you. Finally, never stop learning and never lose the drive you had in the service. You have done much harder things and you've overcome more. The difference is, now on the other side, it's your dream role. So keep your head up. Don't hesitate to reach out to me or the Boots to Books team. Have a great VetSecCon and have a great transition.